quick introduction. My name is Srikanth. I run this volunteer initiative called CashlessConsumer, which aims to make consumers as stakeholders in the payment system. So we track closely every paytech developments closely and put together like consumer perspective into that, so that makes the products consumer friendly, not just in terms of say user interfaces, but the overall experience. A couple of disclaimers. So one is technical disclaimer. I am not from the payment industry. I am an outsider. I'm a consumer. So whatever access to knowledge that I have is from secondhand information and publicly documented specifications, documents, and whatever is there on the web. And I don't have, say, an industry inside access. The other political, so I could be factually wrong, so if I'm wrong, please feel free to correct me. And then the political disclaimer, there are a couple of things. So when talking about UPI, so majority, not maybe in this room, but outside, think that UPI is the government's product, but it's not. It's a product of a private company, which is in the Java settlements, and which is formed by a bunch of banks. And so here we are talking not about, say, country's platform. It's a platform. It's a payment platform by a private company. Let's get that clear. And the other political disclaimer is in the technology world, just around the other Audi, they talk a whole lot of decentralized systems. So that's the Bitcoin ICOs and all those stuff. Whereas, like, we see that UPI is fully centralized system, so to speak. So there may be differences of opinion in that. So I'm not going to go into that. So if you are into that debate, like, we'll probably not talk too much about it. We'll probably get started with the understanding that this is a centralized system. But like, I may have my own political opinions on that. So on, say, the centralized versus decentralized debate and the privacy security debate and those things, I'll try to be an observer from the distance, but please, apologies if I hurt your sentiments. Okay. With that, we'll see a quick overview of what we are planning today. We'll make some platform observations, like how the overall UPI as a platform or an ecosystem is progressing, and what I learned from some of these NPCI circulars, which are there in the public on their NPCI website, and like, how to read between the lines and know what's happening in the UPI ecosystem, right? And I'll also make some technology observations. Technology observations would be like reading through the specs or the how a product is being implemented, and like, so that could be like the design choices that are either technical and how it impacts the user, and also Vimal talked about like a bunch of UPI integration. So we'll see how UPI integrations have and what sorts of design choices they have and how they impact usability. And then we'll talk about consumer observations. So this is like the typical consumer experience. So he just said like 10% merchants don't get a call back, and that results in a poorer experience for the consumers, right? So in that environment, what's the grievance framework, or what's the regulatory framework for disputes, and how long does it take, and things like that. But even when that is aside, then there are still a lot of people loving it, like simply because it makes their payment seamless. We'll see like why people are loving it, and then we'll see into the data debate. So there is a whole lot of discussion around, say, privacy, security of data, Aadhaar, non-Aadhaar, and beside from Aadhaar, there is the concept of, say, centralization and what it could have impact on your privacy and rights. So we'll see what are consumer observations on that. And we'll have a quick sneak peek into what's coming on UPI V2. Right? So firstly, like, we'll see what UPI by numbers are. There are 67 bank issuers. So this means that if you are a customer of one of those 67 banks, you can install in any of these UPI apps and get started transacting on UPI. And this is probably a larger number in India, because typically the mobile banking world had, say, the top 10 banks had rich apps, and then say the next 20 or 30 banks would have some sort of an app where you can transact, and that too maybe in a limited manner, but not to merchants and things like that. But this number of 67 banks is the largest in some sense. Also, although IMPS to an extent has more apps as well. And then there are 44 VPA issuers. So now, to understand this, we need to understand the notion of who is a payment service provider and who is a bank. So bank is where you store your money, but a payment service provider is a service provider with which you interact, and through them you can transact your money that's stored in the bank. So they may be the same. So the bank can be a payment service provider, but say non-banks can as well be a payment service provider. So there are these 44 non-banks, 44 payment service providers who have direct access to the payment infrastructure. They are called the VPA issuers. So you will have all these. In the UPI, you have a VPA where you say Vimal at UPI or something. So that's the at portion. There are 44 different entities that are issuing IDs like that, and they issue 56 IDs. And there are close to 75 apps. We'll quickly see what these apps are. And a small distinction, there are three non-bank PSP partners in UPI. So a distinction will probably, will be covered in tomorrow's talk on regulation as to how banks which are owning and controlling payment systems, and how there are other entities, let's say the Google Pays and PhonePe and Beam. So these are the three entities which are actually technically not owning a banking license, but still have direct access to the payments and settlement infrastructure through partnership agreements. And the numbers, like this is the larger numbers of entire UPI volume and value transacted over the year. So there are 75 apps, right? So what are these 75 apps? Like, why do we need 75 apps to begin with? It's like on this, when we look closer, like there are 49 of these apps are by the banks themselves. So remember, there are 67 banks that are actually UPI enabled, but not all banks need to actually make the apps. So they can just, since the any app in the UPI ecosystem is supposed to be interoperable with any other UPI participating bank. So there are 49 of these banks who've launched their own apps, and 8 of these apps are specifically focused on the merchant acquiring experience. So this is like, these are not the consumer apps which we use, but this will be for the merchant at a point of sale counter. So instead of a POS machine, they could just install an app which can then accept UPI payments. So the 8 of these apps are focused for merchants. And there are 19 deep integration apps. So this could be the Ola, Uber, or the Samsung Pay, or the Truecaller, all these apps which have their own functions, but they also add UPI into their app as an integration, either for their own payment needs, or say, for example, integrating or expanding the UPI footprint. And then while we say this, over the last year, there are 3 apps that have also gone shut. This is because this is a very crowded market, there are a lot of these apps. Probably some companies which did not see value how to make business sense out of this, probably then were like shut. Because beyond a point, paying and receiving and making value out of it is probably very difficult in such a crowded market. The average app update frequency rises somewhere around like a month. So if you are using an app which is not updated for over a long period of time, it's probably time to change an app. Because there are 75 apps and there are apps which are like well maintained. So some platform observations. One is, this is a digitally inclusive platform. So I made the point that 67 banks have onboarded. A large part, some 10 to 20 banks are cooperative banks, and say rural banks which don't have necessarily any digital infrastructure that is well in place, which can interact with say the tier one infrastructure. So all these customers of these banks were probably having only a RuPay debit card, which was not possible to transact online in all places, which they can probably transact at a limited number of merchant establishments. Now they have the ability to transact, say, through the Flipkarts and Amazons and wherever UPI is. So that's the inclusion part in there. And multilingual payments apps. So this is something that around the time of demonetization, there were hardly like two or three apps which are like really multilingual. So beyond English, so the entire payment experience was restricted pretty much to a person only whose knowledge is in English. But now there are probably a dozen apps which are having like multilingual interfaces, and this is becoming a new norm, so that like any new payment company that comes in is probably also automatically getting into the multilingual payment space. And although in the tier one population, the P2P transfers were still at a nascent pace. Only the tech savvy used like a lot of these apps, including say even Paytm before demonetization, right? So it's not probably very common for your parents to use something like this prior to demonetization. But UPI brought a lot of these people into installing these apps and trying out. And the biggest advantage for them is they didn't lose the comfort of storing part of their money in a wallet that they didn't trust much. It's still in their own bank, which they trust better. And so as I said, like UPI decouples the UX to the payment service providers who probably could build better apps, but still inside a banking model. So wherever, so in terms of commercial agreements or anything, you still need to have a partnership agreement with the bank. So and only through that license, you could still get access to this UPI. So what it also made was a lot of these prepaid instruments or wallets were having a lot of these transactions being made digitally, and banks were actually losing in that front. This UPI made a shift of moving the volumes of PPIs into UPI. And it's actually a myth to say that interoperability didn't exist in wallets before, because interoperability means that, say, moving money from, say, your Airtel Money wallet into your ICICI Pockets account. Now, many people might think that this is not possible before and only UPI could make this shift, right? But it's actually not true, because all these, at least both these wallets, they do have cards supported in them, and you could transact money from one of these wallets into the other. So interoperability did exist in a limited way, but UPI broad-based it among the banks, so that like you could transact through any app. And the next, the roadmap on the UPI now has wallets on UPI. So wallets will be soon integrated into UPI. So they'll probably become the payment service providers, or they may even be at some level treated at par with banks over the course of time. So, so that's to be seen, like what sort of integration wallets will be made into the UPI. So the initial phase one would be like only wallet-to-wallet interoperability will exist. In a phase two, when the full KYC is done, probably wallet-to-bank integration would be performed. Okay. Doesn't work. Okay. Then the next observation is UPI is also touted to be the most developer-friendly or developer-first product, which is like having a lot of these APIs which developers can consume easily and build apps faster. But what we've seen is while there have been integrations happening between these apps, they've not been at a scale where the UPI has reached. So the UPI itself, the consumer base have exploded like anything. Like you have these millions of users installing apps and transacting. But when you come to the business side of things, where like the app integrations, there haven't been enough deeper integrations, and the payment experiences still remain largely the same, and probably in some cases it's worse. I'll take an example on IRCTC of how it's actually much harder in UPI. But on one observation, like, there is this new digital chit fund app which is based on UPI. So this is probably, that was not possible before UPI to build as quick as what they've done. But these are the sort of integrations or the applications that could potentially come out of UPI. Although it's like not rolling out faster as expected, right? So then the other thing is about like, is it UPI or Beam UPI? Because there is recent, there is UPI in, UPI was the centralized payment platform that was launched, and Beam was actually one of the applications in UPI. But recently they just changed the convention, like they just called everything as Beam UPI. So let that maybe, but what the point here is, now UPI as a platform is much larger platform covering all these 46 payment service providers, and Beam is one of the payment service providers. And if you look at the market shares of the transaction volumes and values, Beam has actually emerged as a service road kind of thing. So you have this six-lane toll highway, which is like super fast, and then you have a service road on parallel to that. So Beam is emerging as that service road. So you're having this global big tech players, like Google has come in, so WhatsApp is going to come. And then there is the Indian paytech, so you have the Paytms and PhonePays. And also a lot of these startups, so there are probably a dozen startups. And then there are banks, again, big and small. You have the ICICIs, HDFCs, and then there's a bunch of small banks. All of them are in this ecosystem. And it's tough to predict like what is actually moving this ecosystem at what pace. And there have been a bunch of issues in the initial days, so one of which is probably like ICICI blocking PhonePay. There has been friction between the banks and payment service providers and banks within themselves. And like all these were like solved through some sort of rules and regulations around interoperability. And of late there has been recent like tussle around like capital dumping. So is all the volumes and values bigger because there are more cashbacks, and like there are few companies which have the bandwidth to dump capital into cashbacks, but we'll see how that goes. Then I'll quickly walk through the circulars around interoperability guidelines meant that the apps were seamless. Any app to any app, any PSP app to any PSP app works. And one of the interesting observations is that UPI never had a chargeback policy. So unlike cards, which had a chargeback policy, like you could dispute a transaction and then it gets reversed, UPI never had it until recently. So they've recently announced that chargeback process is in place, and like, it may take at most 60 days for you to get your money back for, say, a transaction which you dispute. And there is also a point. So like Dilip explained how multi-tiered this entire process flow when a transaction happens. And that causes a lot of technical failures. So banks have been asked to improve their infrastructure to make sure that the technical declines, failures reduce to 1%. And there's also one more circular which says that you got to make sure, do your due diligence before balance check is enabled in third-party apps. Now, why should my taxi company app, which is integrated UPI, even have the feature to check my balance? Like, is that even a valid use case? So this is probably happening because now banks are become more cautious around like data and data protection. They don't want to have every application have the same sort of access, and they are asking banks to do the due diligence for that. Technology observations, we'll quickly see platform tech observations, the application observations, the QR story, POS, and the integrations. So at a platform level, UPI has something. Has something called an equivalent of one-time virtual NetSafe cards, which is like a use and throw VPA. But sadly, very few, two or three apps support that, and even they are not very usable. So for an end user, there is not much of a privacy option that exists in reality. And UPI also has support for cards and wallets. And they can also technically work with any other settlement system. So right now, they work with the IMPS settlement system, which has its own merits and demerits, but they can technically work with other settlement systems as well. So what are the observations on apps? So every app will have these common features, so to pay, collect, create a VPA, show a QR code, scan a QR code. All these things are pretty standard features across all these apps. There is this bill splitting feature, which was probably there in all the UPI apps, but never took off because maybe socially we aren't engaged, like convinced around the concept of splitting the bills. We probably don't split our restaurant bills as often as people do in the West. All these apps have the reminders to pay bills, and some of these apps also have bill payments integrated through the BBPS, so you can pay all your mobile postpaid bills, electricity bills, utility bills. They also have card payments. They have pay to Aadhaar. This is a small observation here. The pay to Aadhaar is very unsafe in sense, like you key in an Aadhaar, and the response to that pay, by the bank to say that the payment is confirmation, this payment actually happened, it sends back the Aadhaar number in the plain text. So, and the accessibility features, so this again as one of the factors that has improved because of a lot of these apps want to differentiate themselves. So Beam, for example, has a talkback feature which lets enable user to use the talkback feature instead of seeing the screen. So QR codes, so the bigger promise on QR codes is that QR codes will be like everybody will keep scanning and paying, and like this is the Chinese revolution that has happened a couple of years back. People expected that to replicate in India, but sadly it didn't. QR codes are largely used to identify VPS at most when they are used. There's a lack of certification among these apps, so this actually breaks the functionality. So if I create a QR code based on the specification, any other UPI app is also supposed to support it, but in reality it doesn't work. There is and that causes like friction. There are fewer merchant establishments showing actually the stickers, but why? That's because like there is an unclear strategy even within the banks themselves as to whether to use UPI or Bharat QR, and what's the merchant incentives, the merchant discount rates and stuff like that. So UPI does have the Bharat QR integration. A detailed post is out there in the handbook of what this integration is about. But Bharat QR still is non-starter because again the MDR and the discussions around incentivizing payments for the banks is still a discussion between the government and the banks. Then there is also the audio QR. So Google Tez lets you transmit the same QR information through audio, so you can technically make audio payment. And potentially soon, very soon, you'll probably be having also voice-driven payments. So next is the UPI POS thing. So this is a interesting feature from the ground up because the merchants always want a paper receipt. So, and they were far more comfortable with a POS machine because all their employees are trained in POS machines. So they actually innovated the existing POS machine to make it smarter, to add UPI option, which lets the POS machine show a QR code which a person can scan the UPI app, and that actually prints the confirmation, which so it's a success for the merchant. And so that's one hack, but this is not seen much adoption in the market, or maybe because there is not much of awareness within people and the merchants. The other thing that PhonePay is trying is this calculator POS. We need to see how that goes. And the MDR debates are still continuing. That's the crux of the debate, like who will pay the MDR, whether the merchant has to accept the charges or would the government reimburse. So that's, and is that really helping? Currently, it's not. Probably a clearer policy might help. We'll quickly see what kind of integrations are there in UPI. So you have the payment processors. A lot of these payment processors have UPI options. So they ask you to feed in your VPA, and they'll send you a collect request. All you need to do is take your phone and say approve and enter your PIN, and the payment completes. Now, this is probably easier, but we'll come to the hard case of, say, the IRCTC. Now, everybody here would know that IRCTC is like a war zone. Like, you need to make that everything quick there, right? But UPI actually makes it like painfully slower because it first redirects to a page where you need to enter VPA, and then you need to take out your phone, and you need to wait for the collect request notification to come. And once that comes in, you open the open the app, enter the app PIN first to open the app, and then enter the UPI PIN to authorize the transaction, and then wait for that browser screen to actually detect this payment, whether it has gone success or failure, and then move to the payment confirmation page. And after that is where the IRCTC ball comes. Now, this is actually a very convoluted process for making this payment simpler. There are some efforts being made to make this slightly better. but that still won't solve, at least for IRCTC, it won't solve. We'll then see like the app integrations. There are some of these apps, say Uber and Ola, they have tighter app integrations. So, but even they, some of them actually send out collect requests. The problem with that is the collect request is sent out with an expiry time. So the collect request more or less expires. Typically in the case of Uber, you take a ride, you don't open the Uber app again, and you open the Uber app only the next time when you want an Uber. So this problem exists with cards as well with two-factor, and this is not solved with UPI. Probably it may get better with the e-mandates of pre-authorized payments. And there's also this VPA creation hell. So every app that has got tighter integration wants you to create a UPI VPA. That's not always necessary. Actually, you can take an existing VPA and use it, but that's a problem in integration strategy of that particular app. Right? We'll quickly see some of the user risks and attacks. Auto creation of VPA is one risk, then spam control and fraud. So on auto creation of VPA, so Beam auto created with a phone number, which lets, and since the UPI spec also has, like if you provide a VPA and it'll give you back the original verified name of that person. So that became a privacy issue, and then Beam later plugged it with a disabling option to disable such auto-created VPAs. But even today, a large number of PSPs do create auto-create VPAs based on your mobile number. And the reason they say for that is, like, you know, these people are actually, it's too complex for them to even understand the concept of VPA. So we help them get started automatically by auto-creating their VPAs. And that has, let's say, its privacy implications as well. And Google Tez also auto-created their VPAs with the Gmail ID. So if you have ever used your own Gmail ID on Tez, it would have created with your email ID. And that's the ability to actually do this. And what this actually makes is, for an attacker, if he knows your Gmail, if he knows your phone number, he can predict your VPA. And he can raise a collect request. And this, and we'll see in the next slide of, even when that is not the case, there are actually attacks of different kind. So when in a VPA, you can actually have the ability to raise a collect request. So that's the pull mode, right? So anybody can raise a collect request to anyone else. Like if I know your VPA, I can raise a collect request. Now what happens is, if I'm a stranger, I'm spamming you, right? So you can do a spam control and say block all the requests from this particular handle. Now that works if I'm a person. But what if I actually use an e-commerce site? So a case in point here is somebody is actually has harvested my VPA. So there is a list of database of VPAs out there already in the gray market, which has my VPA, which I've never actually transacted. The only place I put this on is on my blog, where I used it for an example. But this VPA got harvested. Somebody is actually using it through Flipkart, and they've actually raised a bulk payment of 76,000. This is probably some LED TV or something. And the best part is, even Flipkart does not know this, because they can't technically know from where it was raised. Although if, say, the deep log monitoring is actually in place, we could trace out. And in one case, I did actually trace out with Paytm. It happened to be some guy in UP. So there are these attacks. These are real. And we need solutions for this. So there are partial solutions, but they're not enough for the fraudsters are always smarter, right? So then we'll actually look at the large scale frauds that have taken place in UPI. So one is the UPI hack in one of the banks, which was possible through a factor that they didn't have a reconciliation process. So what was happening was, a bulk of payments were processing and the other party was getting paid, whereas no money was getting deducted from the account from which the transaction was made. And this was later discovered, and they found some 25 crore value transactions were happening through this. Then there is also this new SIM attack. So in UP, a bunch of guys who were with the bank colluded with some criminals, and they got a new SIM card using, and they also had the debit card details, so they could set the UPI PIN and they transacted. As measures, so UPIs probably need to take a lot more measures against this. So they did try something called as Beam Cyber Security Hackathon. There are some 1,500 people who registered, but nobody ever heard back after that. So we don't know what. And in fact, that probably also has some amount of these hacks listed there. I don't know how that is getting fixed. But essentially, a lot of security education is required among developers and users, and also certification to help like the apps certify. We'll see the consumer observations on regulations. Like the grievance redressal mechanism isn't scaling. So the problem right now is like every other transaction is failing and people are going to like tweet it back. So I have this joke. So people now every now and then tweet to the Prime Minister saying that this transaction failed in Beam. So the reason for that is again like as Dilip said that these are multi-party systems and you need to have a high degree of reliability, reliable systems. And when one of these systems break in the chain, like the transaction fails. Like, so there is one on technology scaling. The other thing is, let's say even if the failure happens, the operations of the banks need to actually scale the support to even at least respond to the support request. So actually every UPI app has a dispute management section. But you'll find that hardly few banks or few PSPs respond to that. And even when they respond, they'll say, we are still looking at it. So there, a lot of these consumers are actually frustrated, and they are probably dropping off the payments. What we also need to help is more open data on QoS parameters of banks. Are their servers up and running at 99.99 or what percentage it is? And so service delivery, or are the transaction processing through fine, like what's the percentage of failures and what's the grievance handling mechanism, SLAs, all these things need to be having an open data. And not just that, the open data around the operations of the network provider itself. So NPCI itself needs to provide open data about what's the QoS parameters of UPI switch. But why are people still loving it? The large number of people actually use it. So this can be seen in the volumes. Although one might say that a lot of these volumes are because of these incentives, but the truth is somewhere in the middle where a lot of people are actually finding value to use these instant payment systems. And it's also because this is the only payment infrastructure which is instant and available widely. And it's a monopoly, so obviously people are going to use it when there are no other choices, right? Because NEFT still takes few hours at best. So UPI will continue to grow, and people will move from NEFT to UPI because it's instant until they realize a point maybe where they see that support is not up to their mark, right? We'll talk about concerns. So there are concerns about data centralization. So if you see the UPI architecture, every transaction that you make gets logged in a central system. So that could cause a very detailed profile of your transaction, which the data of which can be used in multiple ways. So that's one big concern. And the next thing is terms of service loading. So if you have attended, caught up on the last year's talk, we saw that like a lot of these terms of service are like very complicated and they load phrases. And we did highlight that we need simpler terms of service, which is actually clearer to the consumers, and companies can't obfuscate. And after like a couple of months of that, so the Beam app did a terms of service overloading, where they said like, you authorize permission for us to monitor calls between you and other users of UPI, which is essentially phone tapping agreement, right? You authorize them, and then they corrected that, saying that when you call our call center, then we can monitor your calls. Which is at which point NPCI did not even have a call center to begin with. But this is still a concern. Like a lot, we can't keep watching all these terms of service day in and day out. We need to find a better way of how we can do that. And then there's this whole notion of VPA gives you privacy, right? At two levels. So VPA gives privacy only to the transacting party and not with the network. So the network still has a centralized data about your transaction trails, right? And the reason for that is like UPI was probably designed a few years back before the Supreme Court judgment. And UPI needs a privacy-friendly architecture. There will be probably a question. So UPI is highly efficient because it's centralized. and decentralized systems like Bitcoin is burning all the energy, and it's inefficient. So centralization and settlements is always been there in banking and settlements. But we need to figure out, like, can privacy still exist in some sort of centralized settlement architecture? Now, if you've seen the IMPS also is similar architecture, but it's slightly more privacy friendly. There are protocols like Interledger, multiple settlement entities, settlement modes. These are some of the solutions. This is something about what I did. Any coincidences to what somebody else is doing at a very bigger scale are merely coincidences. I call this as metadata surveillance. But people then say, like, no, it's not metadata surveillance. It's fraud and risk management. Now, I did as cashless consumer, I did it to myself. Like, I am actually collecting data without any actual intelligence or actioning on that data. I'm tracking all these UPI apps day in and day out, probably. There's this tracker sheet which lists all these apps, their features and stuff like that. I'm also logging, there will be a tweet from this handle every day as to which app got updated. And I'm logging all the metadata, like each, what's the app rating of each app, what's the new update, what's the recent update on the app, and what's the recent message that they have put on the app update, and all these are getting logged. So again, this is data amassment sans any actual intelligence or action. I'm just dumping all the data. I'm not saying who else is doing this. So we'll quickly peek into UPI V2. What are the features? So one is Aadhaar authentication for transaction authorization. So instead of UPI PIN, you'll use Aadhaar. And then e-mandates, I believe in the next talk, will be covered in detail. And signed intents is the other feature which could probably let you open the app directly if it's a authorized merchant. So we'll Aadhaar authentication may be like, it's going to be too complicated. You need to have a on-the-go pen drive with an Aadhaar device, and that needs to have another app which encrypts your biometrics, and all these things need to be like, and the usability of this is simply just not there. Like, you don't want to plug in an on-the-go device with a biometric reader and then use the biometrics, even if you believe in that, and then, like, the context switches between the apps just to do the authorization is just too hard. Like, probably what can be, this can never probably work even in a secure way, in a privacy friendly way, and in a convenient way. Maybe, like, if we are like 5 years down the line, there may be a situation where a secure voice biometrics is actually there, like where your authorization is also through your voice biometrics, but we are still not there right today. E-mandates will change the way how EMIs are done. There's also option of push and pull mandates, something like similar to push and pull payments. So it's not that always you need to sign up the EMI form, that your provider can sign up and you just approve. And this also has a QR, so you can probably scan QR codes on a website which does say subscriptions, and you can do with like one click or two click subscriptions. So use cases, taxi rides, so pre-auth payments for taxi rides. So UPI, Paytm already existed. They're right now bringing that back into UPI itself. So like your taxi rides can be automatically paid, and say food delivery subscriptions. The biggest bet for them is like the consumer durables EMIs. So right now you have to fill up forms and get these EMIs, or say some cards offer you at the checkout to convert them as EMIs, or now you need to call up the customer care. All that's going to be a history. You're going to have like UPI mandates which can do EMIs. But this also has some concerns around, are mandates valid without signature? And you are actually liable for your mandates. So, and mandate bounce is treated at par with check bounce. So that could affect your credit score. That could affect technically a merchant can do criminal proceeding against you as well. And there are a lot more gray areas around, say, e-sign as well, which needs to be discussed deeply. So signed intents, again, like we are moving into a world of audio QR, NFC, Bluetooth, where you don't actually see what's coming in over the air. There's a possibility of man-in-the-middle attacks. So they're going to hash the entire intent. And so that hashing and through through a signature which is like given for the pre-approved merchants. So that's the signed intents part of it. And that's it.